says, let go of the limb. Let go of the limb and take my hand. And the man hanging on the side of the cliff with the branch breaking says, is there another way? Is there another way I can get out of this situation without letting go of the branch that's about to break anyway? So as he goes down, the man says, by the way, my name is God. So many of us are in a place because we want to do it our way. We want to do it our way, and we're not letting God do it his way. So I'm going to challenge you this morning to ask God for a sign. Ahaz is a king. He's the king of Judah. He's the king of Judah, and he is a king who is known to be wicked. He is not a good king. He is a king that they have said he's compromised God. He's compromised his position. He got in cahoots with people who don't believe in his God. They don't believe in his God, but he did it to get what he wanted because he thought God can't handle the tax situation. God can't handle sex-ass marriage. God can't handle abortion. This is today. I'm just kind of connecting it. So they come into cahoots with people who don't believe in their God. And God said he was a man. The word says he was a man who compromised his position. You get a chance to look at 2 Chronicles and also look at Kings, where it talks a little bit more about him, how he started worshiping pagan gods. Corrupt communication and corrupt fellowship will soon corrupt you. Keep playing with folks you shouldn't be playing with and talking to folks you shouldn't be talking to and having fellowship. Now, you ain't having fellowship because you need Jesus to have fellowship. All right. All you doing is hanging out. Hanging out with folks you shouldn't be hanging out with because they're going to eventually corrupt you. I know we think our light is so bright, right, ain't gonna never overtake me. All right.
Jesus.
All right, so here we go. This king is the king of Judah. He's also known to be kind of cowardly. Because he would go behind people's backs and do things. He was corrupt. He was also disobedient. God calls him, remember earlier in the scripture, he says, ask your God. Ask your God, which means God is his God.
Right.
But it is clear to me that he has not made God his God. Because he came into agreement with Assyria. He was looking for some spiritual, he was looking for a greater place. He was looking for other people to protect him from other people. And so he sacrificed one of his sons to a pagan God. Because he wanted more spiritual position. Then he came into agreement with the king of Assyria. Now, everybody know that's their enemy. But he thought he could protect him better than God. Mm-hmm. So we want to do it our way. He was a pagan worshiper. He tried to position himself in Judah into these partnerships with enemies. Watch who you get into partnership with. Watch you get into partnership with, and let me say this, relationship with. I think I can say that. Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
So here we are, and we have this king. He thought that other people could protect him better than God. Why did he not trust God? Why didn't he trust God? Because he trusted in himself more than he trusted in God. I call King Ahaz the following unbeliever. You're a follower of God, but you really don't believe.
Right.
You really don't believe. Years ago, I think it was when, actually I know, it was when I was at our previous covering. We were doing our first fast, our first 40-day fast. It was right before Hill Extreme started. And we were doing our first fast. And I remember this was probably one of the first times that God spoke to me. And I heard him say as clear as day, my people believe in me, but they don't believe me. It's enough for your name to be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, but you really don't believe that I'm God.
Right.
About 3 months later, I was walking through the Christian bookstore that was over there by Applebee's on Lafayette Road, and there in the bookstore was a book titled Believe God, and Beth Moore had written it. And I opened it up to the first page. I said, I gotta get it, and I stood in the middle of the bookstore, and the first sentence says, my people believe in me, but they don't believe me. I said, did I miss my opportunity to write a book? There it was. We believe in God to get our names written. But we don't really sometimes believe he's really God. He's going to do what he said. The way he said it. The challenge often is when you going to do it. Somebody say, I'm going to ask for a sign. All of this was known about this king, King Ahaz, but he had one good thing about him, and it was his son. And I'm going to tell you who his son was in just a minute. That was the only good thing about this wicked man. In verse chapter 3, God sends in chapter 3, God sends Isaiah to the king, and he says, take your son, Shear-Jashab, take him. Now, this is the thing. God sent Isaiah with a visible prophecy of the promise. Somebody ask me, why is that? How is that? Somebody ask me. How is that? Because his son's name literally meant that the remnant will return. So standing right next to the prophet was a visible manifestation that I'm telling you, none of these kings ain't gonna do nothing to you because the remnant is gonna return. You just bypass all the signs, everything I'm showing you. And you might, no, I'm not gonna ask for a sign. I don't believe that. How many prophecies do you need, beloved? How many times does somebody have to come and look at you over the cliff and say, I'm here to help, but you don't want to do what they say? Well, I don't want to do that. I tried that already, but God has sent a word your way. God has sent the prophet. He sent the Logos word. He sent the Rhema word. He sent the prophetic word. How many words did you need? He came in a dream. Good God Almighty. He didn't came. But how many times do we say, but I don't want to do it that way. I don't trust that. But we still praying to this God. We're still praying to him. We're still asking him. Now, what's crazy is that King Ahaz's name literally means God holds. How your name mean what you need, and you just denying God and being just God holds you. Yeah. God has held you. God has kept you. Your very existence that these kings can't come against you is because God got you. Yeah. It's in your DNA, boo. I'm going to go in cahoots with somebody else. I'm going to go into partnership and relationship with somebody else because I think they can help me better than God. Oh my God. It happens. Now, this is what God wants you to understand. Remember he told Isaiah, he said, listen here, go to the south. And it was in, I believe, about verse 3. He said, go to the south of the city. Go to the inn where the aqueduct is. He'll be by the pool. All of this stuff. He tells them exactly where to go, don't he? He said, if he's into the upper pool, listen, God knows where you're at. God knows exactly where you're at. He knows exactly how to get that word to you. He knows exactly how to bless you. He knows exactly how to answer your need. God knows where you're at. He knows that you're hanging on the side of the cliff. He knows that you're in a dark situation. He knows that the branch is about to break. You're holding on at the end of the thread. He knows exactly where you are, and he can get your answer exactly to you. How are you going to find me over here? Does God know what's going on with me? Yes, he does. He knows exactly where you are, and he knows the answer that you need. Somebody say, I'm going to ask for a sign. So in the middle of nowhere, God sends the prophet. In the middle of your situation that's going bad, a marriage going bad, a job getting ready to close, your finances jacked up, God knows it. God knows you're in between I don't know and what if. God knows you're in the hallway of decision. God knows that every door in the hallway is closed. He knows it. But he'll tell you, knock on this one, try to turn. He knows where you're at. So here we are. God tells him, listen, calm down, dude. Don't be tripping. I'm telling you, I got you. Years ago, God told me, this has been years, I remember I was somewhere in a state building downtown, and this lady asked me, for whatever reason, she asked me my name, and I told her Tuesday, and she said, do you know your name means grace in Swahili? That blessed me. That blessed me because this was years. This was probably 20, 30 years ago. And I'm like, really? And then as I started following things and getting close to God, I started studying the numbers. So my birthday is May 5th. Anybody know what numbers mean, right? So 5 is the number of grace. Double 5 is mercy. Y'all don't play with me. Listen, from the existence of your mama's womb, goodness and mercy has followed you, crazy girl. That's the only reason you didn't got out of some stuff that you got in. But should you go on sinning so that grace may abound? Certainly not. Certainly not. God forbid. But goodness and mercy has followed you all the days of your life. My father's seventh grade education didn't know what Tuesday meant. He barely was saying he sung the gospel, though. He didn't sing this part of the gospel, but my dad had a good voice. So he sang, but he didn't know what that meant. But my name means grace. I was birthed into grace, yeah, and mercy, and it follows me all the days of my life. So when I found the scripture, y'all, and goodness and mercy, I said, oh yeah, I'm going to claim that. Claim some stuff over your life. You got to start speaking. Your very existence has purpose. Find the scripture and put it on your life. This is me. This is about me. Yeah, everybody quote it. Everybody preach it. They might sing it. But this one here is for me. The God Almighty. Ah, I love him. I love him. Ask for a sign. Ask for a sign. It goes on to say in verse 7. He said, but God, the master, is telling you, none of this will happen to you. None of this can come to pass. And so what do all these names mean? Basically, God is telling the king, listen, all of these people, go to verse 8, all of these people belong to me. Damascus belongs to me. Ephraim belongs. All of these people belong to me. And I'm telling you that they can do nothing to you. That company is surviving because you're there. I know everybody else got a pink slip. But you need to declare, I'm not going nowhere. And God, if it's for, if I go somewhere, it means you got something better for me.
That's it.
You need to start walking in your authority. God has placed you in this earth in certain jobs, in certain positions, at certain times, so that you can declare a thing. So you can set the atmosphere so that things can change. Can't do nothing. They can't do nothing. I own them and I own you. Nothing can happen to you. Ah, we quote the scripture, he has the power to turn the hearts of kings. Do you really believe it? I almost want to say stop saying the singing stuff you don't believe. But then I do know that if you keep saying it, if you keep singing, sooner or later, your words don't catch up with your heart. Hallelujah. Yes, yes, yes. We love God. We love God. So here we are at the end of verse 9. We're at the end of verse 9. And in my translation, this is the Message Bible. I think I pulled the amplified over right here. It says, if you will not believe and trust God and his message and his messenger, be assured that you will not be established. You ain't going to have nothing to stand on. Listen. So if you don't take your stand in faith, you won't have a leg to stand on. Why would Isaiah all of a sudden just say this out of nowhere? Because he discerned the heart of the king. He knew he wasn't believing. All this that God said he was going to do, he knew he wasn't going to believe it. Y'all know, intercessors, ministers of the gospel. You looking at him, you tell him God's going to do it, and they just looking at you like, amen, let's pray. Amen, when it's finished, you open your eyes. Their eyes been open the whole time. They weren't praying in agreement with you. You talking about amen, like amen. They don't walk away with no hope. They don't walk away like, yes, God, don't do this. I believe God. You like, well, say something. You agree?
Come on.
Well, see, remember, he comes right behind him, and he says, okay, so since you're going to believe, he said, I'm going to say this to you. Ask God for a sign. This is when we ask you, when we're praying for you, when we're coaching and counseling and advising you, we're like, what does this dream mean? What did God tell you the dream meant? Can you help? Okay, have you prayed about your situation before? And then when you pray, what did God say to you? What did he say? So this was Isaiah. He said, okay. So all your unbelief, you gotta believe. So since you don't believe, let me just tell you, ask God for a sign. So you testing him. Yeah, he did. Ask God for a sign. Didn't King Ahaz sound real, like holy? Did he sound holy? He sound holy right up in here somewhere. Let's see, about verse 12. This is where he sounds real holy.
Has nothing to do with God's purpose
or power being manifest, being made manifest. Nothing. Just because we don't believe what God said, it don't mean that he ain't going to do it. It does not affect him not being able to do it, not being willing to do it, and that he wants to do it. Your unbelief, I don't give nothing for that. What it will affect is your ability to see it done. What it will affect is your ability to recognize when it comes and rejoice when you get it. Because you didn't miss it. It didn't went over your head. Lord, help. Help my unbelief. Help my unbelief. I don't want the prophet or anybody else rolling up on me checking my unbelief. You got to believe. You got to believe. Don't miss your moment. God wanted me to make sure I tell you, don't miss your moment. It may or may not come back around. But don't miss your moment.
True.
Don't miss your moment. God's word tells us in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 about verse 20, he says, if you believe God, you will be established. But if you believe his prophet, you'll prosper. Some of you, you believe this word, you're established. You're standing, barely, but you haven't prospered. You haven't advanced. You haven't put the prophetic word, the word of God, into action. Faith without works in. You got to ask for a sign. You got to get to moving. You got to do the part that God has called you to do. Let me help you with something. God can heal every situation. He can manifest it spiritually, physically. He can do it. But some of us, he's told us to do something.
Right.
You want to do it. You want to keep hanging. Hanging on to the limb talking about what's your name. Doesn't matter what my name is if I'm here to help. Get me up off the side of this cliff. Good God Almighty, we want to know what's your name. Now, I'm 200 pounds. How much you weigh so I can know you can hold me when you put me up? Quit asking questions and take your help. I know. You're not sure if you can trust that person to really help you, because everybody that's coming to help ain't really coming to help, because everybody that's with you ain't for you. Judas was with God, but he wasn't for Jesus. He was with him, but he wasn't for him. Yeah. So every time, you got to be discerning, right? You got to be discerning. Some of you are waiting for the pastor to give you a sign. But the truth is, he's seen you hanging on the side of the cliff for how long? And he's been telling you how to get up from the side of the cliff. He didn't put his hand out. He didn't call you. He didn't sit there. So now the branch is breaking. Now your emergency, you want it to become our emergency.
Right.
We've got 50 million other things to do. And if we don't respond, we ain't gonna see you for 3 months, if at all. I'm here to help. You hanging on the side of a cliff and your branch is breaking. You're hanging by a thread. You need help. And help has come. I want nobody to know my business.
Come on.
You ain't got no business. You in a desperate situation. You ain't got no business. Just lay it all out. This is my situation. I need help.
Help. Hallelujah.
You see? Amen. So, believers, prophets, you'll prosper. You got to be transparent. You got to be truthful so you can prosper. I tell people all the time, accountability is only as effective as the truth you tell. That's a tweetable. Accountability is only as effective as the truth you tell. So you're being accountable. But if you don't tell them the truth, they can only help you according to the truth you tell them.
That's it.
So he didn't want to be accountable. So he was acting all, you know. So this was Isaiah's response. He said, look, it is bad enough that you make people tired with your pious religiosity. That's what that word means. That's what pious means. And your timid hypocrisy. Now, I thought purposes. What do you say? Oh, okay, so this is what you're saying, God. Your weak pretense that you for real say. It's a weak pretense. Because today, you praising God at work and you see you got Kirk playing, you got Fred Hammond, you got Marvin, you got everybody playing today. Then tomorrow you cussing somebody out. It's a timid hypocrisy. You don't even know how to be a hypocrite. You don't even know how to do it. And part of the reason you don't know how to do it is because God is in you and he's not letting you go all the way. So you ain't strong in your hypocrisy. You're a little weak in it. You pick and choose when you wanna be a hypocrite. Mm-hmm. So he said, so you want to tell everybody else, David and all your people, not David, but all David's people, which is really that king's people of Judah, those people. He said, so you want to tell everybody else what to do, but you don't want to do it.
Right.
You want to be the sounding board for how society is supposed to live, but you not living that way.
Yikes.
You want to tell somebody how you should treat other people, but you not treat people that way. Now, this isn't about us making mistakes. This isn't about we have a good day, we have bad. No, this is your lifestyle. He said, and I'm tired of it.
Yeah.
And the people are tired of it. And now you have made God tired.
Yeah.
Trying to answer me, come on, no, I don't want to tell God. I don't want to ask God that. You know? Just false humility. Absolutely. He said, okay. He said, so this is what I'm going to do. So this is what God said. He said, I'm going to send you a sign anyway. And he said, and watch what the sign's going to be. If you go on, this is where God starts talking about, you know, God being, Jesus being birthed, wonderful counselor, all of that, that wonderful scripture that we all read. But this is where God wanted me to rest my path. All of these religions and traditions that have told you don't ask God for a sign, we don't want to tempt God, but don't ask God for a sign, don't fleece him. Even when the prophet fleeced God, God didn't really trip on that. Let it be drown this side, God let it be drown. Let it be wild, drown that side, God did. He did it. And then the third time he asked, God was like, dude, I'm just going to go do what I came to do. He didn't even debate him because he knows we're human. He knows we're human, and he knows we need to be comforted. You asking God to show you a sign is so that you can have peace, so that you can become. Am I really going to be healed, God? Send me a sign.
Yeah.
Is my marriage really going to be restored? Send me a sign. God, in fact, the Lord said this. He said, every building that you stepped into that encouraged you, he said it was a sign of what's to come. But sometimes we miss it because we're looking like, man, and not say our pastor, but I'm going to be honest. I'm like, well, God, you did it for them. Do it for our pastor. Do it for our church. I said it.
Yeah.
He's serving. He's a servant and faithful to God. I said it.
Yeah.
I said his integrity is known across this city. That's why Ahaz's son, who you're going to find out who he is in a minute, was a sign that is coming. Now ask God specifically for the sign.
Yeah.
This is so tough that Isaiah tells the man of God, he said, this is being ridiculous. Just be extreme. extravagant. Ask for the moon. Don't be scared, y'all. Ask for the stuff. You know, God, just my account is negative. Just let them. You got 5 overdrafts. Just let them take 1 away. No, I'm taking away. God is inviting you to this place because you can ask God a question. Remember Jesus? If it's possible, take this cup. Jesus asked God a question when he was weary. When he was like, I know he knew what he came to do. He knew what the outcome was going to be. But he still asked Jesus. He still asked his Father. He still asked God. Is it possible? Take this cup from me 3 times. Paul asked God 3 times. People telling you, hey, don't we keep asking God? I keep asking till I see it happen. Because you're asking with faith. If it's not by faith, it's a sin. That's the word. But if you ask him by faith because you believe in the God who you serve, you believe in the God whose son you confess as Savior and Lord, you can ask him to heal you. And how will I know? Kidney disease. God, show me somebody who has kidney disease, but they go into the bathroom. Send me a sign. My child is wayward. They've been out on the street. Show me, give me a sign. Let them call home. Single people, you want to be married? Send me a sign that I'm going to be married. Let somebody who's 50, 60 years old, first sign, get married. Thank you for the sign. If you do it for them, you'll do it for me. That's God for a sign. You believe that God has said you're going to be wealthy and you got a credit score of 550? Send me a sign that God is going to turn that thing around. Ask him and ask for the moon. God gives you that privilege. He gives you that right. He says, ask, seek, and knock. Why did he tell you to ask, seek, and knock? Because he ain't going to do something with it.
My God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Good.
Make your request made known unto God. Your request and your supplications and your petitions. Go study that. They're 3 different things. Pray. And pray all of them.
Amen.
So, somebody might ask me as we come to the end of this thing. So give us an indicator, Pastor Susie, Mr. Tate, where in the Bible, where else did God allow somebody to ask him for a sign? Remember I told you about Ahaz's son? His son was also a king. And he was one of the great, he was the greatest king in the Bible of Judah. They love the Lamb, has so much favor with God. Somebody asked me, who was that?
Who was that?
Hezekiah. And their son, this wicked king, this corrupt king, this king who made alliances with his enemy just so that he could somehow gain some type of favor and get done what he wanted to get done. Who had a God who called him his God, but he didn't call God his God. That's who his daddy was. Hezekiah. We can turn to that. 2 Kings verse 20. Are we going to start? Are we starting at verse 20, verse 8? Thank you. Hezekiah said to who? Same king, same prophet. Look at that. Look at that. Y'all know something about to happen, don't you? He said, Hezekiah said to Isaiah, let me tell you a little bit about what's happening here. Y'all know this story. Isaiah had come to Hezekiah and told him, you gonna die. Get your house in order, you gonna die. You gonna die. And Hezekiah turned his face to the wall. And he started praying. Y'all know the little shabbat. But he went on into God. He turned his face. Sometimes you gotta turn your face. Shut everybody out. Turn the phone off, turn the TV off, turn everything off, turn the pot on the stove off so you don't be scared. It's gonna catch fire, it's gonna dry out. Turn everything and everybody off and get your face to God. On the floor, on the wall. He turned his head and he put his head towards the wall and he started praying to God. He was reminding God. He wasn't being arrogant. He wasn't being arrogant to say, God, I've done this, I've done that, started. We're not going there, but when you get a chance, start at verse 1. He tells him, listen, God, I've done this, I've done that. I followed all of your laws. I've been a good king. Before he could finish praying, the Bible says, Isaiah, before he could get into the outer court, he turns around and he goes back and he tells Hezekiah, God is going to heal you. God is going to heal you. He's going to extend your life 15 years. So here we are in verse 8. Hezekiah said to Isaiah, how do I know whether this is of God, my healing is of God, or if this is the fig plaster because they took fig leaves and put it over his sores? He said, how do I know if this is going to be from God or if this is going to be because of the medicine I'm taking? How do I know that what you're doing is going to be from God? How do I know you're going to fix my marriage? How do I know you're going to help with my children? This is what goes on to say. What confirming? Somebody say it. What confirming? What's that word? What confirming sign is there that God is healing me? Listen, does it say that he's going to heal me? It says that he's healing me. Somebody say right now.
Right now.
He's doing it right now. God is saying he's doing it right now. Just because you don't see it. Just because it don't feel like it. God Almighty. He said, what's the confirming sign that God is healing me? Listen, and that in 3 days I will walk into the temple of God on my own legs. Let me park right here. Hezekiah wasn't tripping on 15 years, y'all. He wasn't concerned about the 15 years. Thank you for the 15 years. Thank you that you're going to keep putting a covering over the city. Thank you that the people are going to be blessed. Thank you that you're going to go after my enemy. But I want to know that you gonna heal me so I can go to church?
Yeah.
Woo! You gonna heal me so I can go to the temple of God? That's what I want to know. In 3 days, I'm gonna get up so I go. So send me a sign. Send me a sign that I can go to church. Good God Almighty! When I left my job in corporate America, I said, God, I ain't got no time. I don't have the time. But when somebody gave me $20 for my birthday, I gave God $5. Don't play. Because I didn't have the time. I literally went from giving hundreds of dollars to the house of God to nothing when I left my job. Oh, I need a tithe. God told me, listen, not only has your name kept you, but you're bringing your tithe into the storehouse. That has kept you. Because I rebuked the devourer for your sake. Every time you bring it in, he wanted to expose you. Yes, he did. He wanted to get you. Yes, he did. But I said, no. This is one of mine. She's a worshiper. She's a giver. She's a sower. She brings her tithe into the storehouse. He ain't brought me back to my six figures yet. But he gonna do it and he gonna do more than that. So if you can give a little now, oh my God, you gonna get great things. Christmas presents, honey, $20. People be like, what you want for Christmas? Money? Because I am a God. Because I left corporate for ministry almost 20 years ago. They give me that. I give a tithe, more than a tithe to the church.
Thank you, Lord.
But your tithe, tithers, it keeps you, it protects you. He rebukes the devourer. He rebukes the devourer over your health, over your relationships, over your finances. It's not just money. If I rebuke the devourer, he didn't say just over your check.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Hezekiah, you know Hezekiah knew about what his daddy did. You knew that his dad, he knew his daddy tried to be all pious and holier than thou, won't ask God. I just said, I'm going to break that generational foolishness. I'm going to break that generational pride. I'm going to ask God for a sign. I'm going to ask him because I'm a worshiper. Anybody a worshiper? I'm a believer. I serve God. And because of this relationship, I can ask God for some stuff. I can be a little bolder than how other people may be. I remember people used to say to me, because I would pray prayers like David, break their jaw, cause them to fall into a pit that they dug for me. I did, I prayed, and I still do. How can you pray like that, you know, as a Christian? Because this is the word. David prayed. David wasn't perfect. But because of my relationship, you coming after me? There's a scripture for you. I ain't got to pray my stuff. Just pray God. good words, but anyway. So he said, 15 years since I'm going to cover you. I'm a king of Syria. The same king that his daddy was went into cahoots with. God said, I'm going to protect you from him. He said, and I'm going to cover the city with my shield. Hezekiah said, okay, cool. Okay, cool. He said, you ain't got to wait. I ain't going to wait for you to ask me to ask you for a sign. I'm going to ask you for a sign. Isaiah said, I'm going to give you a choice. This is something that makes me happy. I'm going to give you a choice. When you have a relationship with God, I'm going to give you a choice.
Yeah.
Give you choices. Yeah. You want him or you want him?
Yeah.
You want her or you want her?
Yeah.
They both holy.
Yeah.
They both love Jesus.
Yeah.
You want that job, you want this job. They both gonna put you in a great place. But which one you want? He'll give you choices.
Yeah.
He'll give you choices.
Yeah.
He'll give you options, and you just choose. You just choose because both gonna be good. They're gonna answer your request. They're gonna meet your need. You want this church or that church? You want where you want, and it's gonna be exactly the way that you want it, because this is how you ask for it. So this is what Hezekiah says. He asked me, he said, do you want the shadow to advance 10 degrees on the sundial, go forward, or do you want it to go back? He said, you choose.
Lord have mercy. Glory to God.
This stuff the word makes me happy, y'all. I get kind of good here. So,
yeah.
Verse 10 says, he goes on, he says, Hezekiah says, it'd be too easy for the sun to go advance forward. That's too easy. God, that happened every day. That happened all the time. He said, that's what you do. He said, make it go back.
Right.
Make it go back.
Glory. Hezekiah told his daddy, ask for the moon.
You know the moon is a type of sun, a star, right? Hezekiah used the real sun. Going from grace to grace, from glory to glory. Ask God for the ridiculous. God used the real sun. He was like, oh, we're going to deal with the moon. We're going to use the sun. God will use what you need, what's already in your life, to remind you that I got you. None of that has to happen to you. If it happens to you, it's because you moved out of my shadow.
Yes.
You came from under my covering.
Yes, Lord.
I believe, this is Tuesday, I didn't read it in any commentary, I didn't get it. I believe this is what the Lord showed me. That by God using his father's sundial, it put his father back in the right place with his son. Because his father knew his daddy was wicked. But God would use my daddy's stuff to help me. God would use what my father did and created to prove to me, to bring me peace, to bring me comfort, that you, my heavenly father, got me. That's good news.
Amen.
God will use something from your past that you deem wasn't good. That you thought, oh, that's not, that. Oh, that'll, he'll never use that. I was this, I was that, I did this, I did that. But he'll use that. He'll use it to show you, I got you. Because all things work together for good because you love him. And you're called according to his purpose. It's his purpose. It's his plan. Ain't got nothing to do with you. Even in that scripture, he said those kings were coming after Judah. They weren't coming after King Ahaz. They were coming after Judah. He's coming after your praise. He's coming after your purpose. It ain't got nothing to do with you. It's coming after your destiny and what and how God wants to use you. So he'll let you keep hanging on the side of the cliff talking about what your name is. Are you for me or against me? I'm here to help. Don't worry about that. So I encourage you today. I encourage you today to ask God for a sign. Ask him for a sign. And be specific. This is how I need you, Lord, to bring me peace. Not because I don't believe you. I certainly believe in you. But I need to know that I know that I know so I can keep walking this journey. I'm going to end with this story. I posted it, but I'm going to end with this story. Several years ago, probably 15, 20 years ago, God had showed me in a dream. It was an open vision, this house. And this house had a half-circular driveway. And that week I had done a teaching on Facebook Live about Ask for a Sign. I really wasn't thinking about it for me. I was encouraging the other people from 2 Kings. And so he showed me this house, and there was this is 20 years ago, y'all. And so when I walked, there was pillars in front of the house. When I walk into the house, there's a great foyer. It's a great foyer. It's grand. Then there's a great room. And this great room is kind of sunken in, 2 stairs, open vision. To the left was my office. To the right was the kitchen and the family room. And off the family room were all of these glasses. Just beautiful. It goes out to a patio. And the patio had a jacuzzi and a gazebo. The stairway in the foyer was a double stairway. You get up, there's a landing. You look over into the great room. Awesome. This is a vision. And over the years, I would just meditate on this house. Had long stopped thinking about it. One of the things I had said about this house, I would love it. It had a mother-in-law's quarter. And I remember 20 years ago thinking, wow, you know, my husband, my mom, they would need an elevator. That's cool because they don't have to take all them stairs. A week and a half ago, I go to Tennessee to a leader's training under another mentor. And he has dinner at he and his wife's home. We go into the house. I'm the first one who comes to the door. He was like, hey, Tuesday. I'm like, hey, Bishop. Hey, man, no big deal. They take my coat. In the vision 20 years ago, when I walk in the house, that's what happens. And it's like, hey, how you doing? Hey, this to whatever they said. They took my coat, they hang it up. We go through, it was a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful home. And we have dinner, we have fellowship, no big deal. I go back to my hotel, we got another training that morning. About 3:30, 4:30, somewhere in there, I jumped straight up out of my bed and sit straight up. And the Holy Spirit reminded me 20 years ago of this dream. I fell out the bed in worship, and I said, let me get up out this hotel before I just send everybody to send security. So I got to the workshop real early. But what God showed me was the house I was in the bishop's house was the house God showed me 20 years ago. literally. Everybody say literally. Except they called the fourth floor of their home, Pastor, the grandmother's quarters. Everybody, the whole fourth floor. With an elevator. I encourage my soul that Christians who love God was doing it like this. But God, this is what the Holy Spirit said to me. I put you in your promise that's to come. I put you in the prophecy of your promise that's to come. Right smack dab in it. And y'all, I almost missed it. Except the Holy Spirit woke me up the next day and said, that was the house I showed you 20 years ago. And it shall come to pass. It is happening right now. Ask God for a sign. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Stand up.